So my name's Emmanuel, Emmanuel Lachey. First, before I talk, I want to give a shout out to BSG Convergence, my cousin Leslie Oduro doing his thing out there, just trying to help out the youth. He's geared towards helping out the youth. So R.A.Y Area Youth, what we are, we're pretty much an organization designed to help youth either get off the streets or just give them something productive to do with their time. We offer basketball programs. Soon we'll be having a boxing program. And I'm trying to get people to come in and talk to the youth and just share some of their experiences when they were growing up in the city of Toronto. Because as we know, the city of Toronto right now is pretty troublesome. Youth are shooting each other not too far away from here. Kipling, there was a stabbing. There was a stabbing at Islington and Finch. I mean, these things are rampant within our community. So anything that we can do to try to get these kids off the street, try to get these kids to stop causing trouble, I mean, it's greatly appreciated. And shout out to also Lamp and Ray for being pillar organizations to just be geared towards helping the youth. A lot of people can follow what they have pretty much installed and have implied in our neighborhoods. Someone that's been helping out with the youth, you know, using basketball to reach out. We know that Toronto right now is a city that is pretty much an uproar with violence and drugs and sex. So we figure, why not try to interview someone that's trying to make a change in our community? So right now we have Antwi Atuahene. For those who don't know, he has a long list of basketball credentials. He played at Arizona State point guard. He now plays for London Lightning, which is also a pro league, the NBL, which is up and coming for in Canada. So yeah, you guys, viewers, welcome Antwi Atuahene. Nice to meet you, man. Thank you for coming in.
Pleasure's all mine.
So we have a few questions for him. I mean, he's an active member in the community, active member, just helping out with the youth. And we figure, what drew him to helping out as much as he has? So how did we all get started?
Really, all got started. Like, I think I came back home from. It must have been Lebanon. I was playing in Lebanon for a short stint. Things didn't go as well. After a while, I realized when I was home, I needed something to do my time productive.
Okay.
So, while I was doing that, I went back to my old school library car.
Right.
And I seen a lot of the kids in the hallways.
Right.
Kids were doing things that I was doing when I was younger, thinking it was cool.
Right.
So, that kind of got to my mind, like, I need to kind of help out to the next generation,
right,
guys on the right track. So, they don't have to go through the same loopholes that I did when I got to college.
Right.
So, me seeing that, started reaching out to the kids, reach out to Coach Melnick, reach out to people like Father Henry Carter, and started getting involved with their practice here and there, and that built on something to the next level.
Right. Wow. So what were your role model growing up in Toronto? You know, it wasn't easy. I know back in the day, there was a lot of violence. What did you look towards? What brought you through all the troublesome and the acts of violence? How did you make it through Carr? How did you make it to where you were at Arizona State? I mean, it's an interesting story.
Man, to tell you the truth, growing up, I wasn't the best kid. I grew up in being very mischievous, getting in trouble at like early age, from grade 6 to grade 8.
Okay.
Once I got to around 9th, 10th grade, I realized I had a gift from God where I could play this game.
Right.
And I wanted to take it to the next level. My parents, my father, being from Ghana, and my mother being from Ghana, they were real strict on me staying being in school. And,
right.
And I was doing the opposite. But then from my friends, kind of.
Right.
And a lot of people that I hung out with, and really geared myself towards basketball and focused it. And I knew I wanted to go to Division 1. Like, that was my dream. It wasn't even the NBA. My dream was to go to Division 1. And people would always tell me, you're crazy.
Right.
Like, this, Now it's different because you have guys that are Division One all the time. Right? Those days it wasn't guys like that. Like it was tough to even get a letter.
Right.
I worked really, really hard, and I told myself I was gonna make it. Right. I met up a couple coach role, right. And got recruited by a lot of schools, and I eventually made it.
Wow, that's a great story. Another question that I had for you. We see a lot of up and coming basketball players in Toronto, in Canada. What advice would you give to them? What advice would you give them to propel them to that next level? What would you give?
The main thing, because it's much different for them growing up now. Because right. Growing up, I didn't have social media.
Right.
I didn't have Twitter. Right. It wasn't YouTube. It wasn't Facebook. Right? So now everything you do get amplified.
Right.
And also when you mess up, right. It gets amplified.
Right.
So my main thing is for anybody who wants to get to that next level, work hard and stay grounded. The biggest thing you do is work as hard as you can on the basketball court and stay grounded. Don't get too caught up in social media.
Right.
Don't get too caught up in what people say about you, what's going on Instagram.
Right.
Kind of step away from it. You can see the greatest ones, like Kobe Bryant, those guys.
Right.
They're just recently getting all that stuff.
Right.
But stay grounded and work as hard as you can on the court and make that speak for you. Other than that, all the other stuff is just noise around you. Stay as forward as you can and get to the next level. Like you put all the effort into the game, it'll always love you back. That's how I know it's about basketball. You try to cut corners in this game, with basketball, you never succeed. They always come back to get you. All the guys in the NBA that you see cut corners, you see what happens to them. They leave for 3 or 4 years and they're gone. As long as the line, you put that work in, it reciprocates all the time.
You guys, you hear that? I mean, this is coming from a Division I player, Florida State, now plays for London Lightning, pro NBL. Another question, how were your experiences playing with James Harden? I mean, a lot of people heard that. How was that? Did you actually play with him? Did he come in after? How did that work out?
In my senior year, James came in. He was a freshman.
Okay.
So we played together that whole year. And when he first came into the school,
right.
I remember he was this young kid. And he was good. He was okay, but he was kind of soft a little bit.
Right.
So I think it was our job to kind of beat him up and kind of get him kind of a little bit tougher. And all of a sudden, when I seen him, I always see him sneaking back into the gym, getting extra hours in.
Okay.
That's when I knew he was going to be something different.
Right.
We would go for a practice. And we had something called rec bullets. Mm-hmm. All of us guys on our team would go to the rec. So now you're talking about guys who are going to school on scholarship playing maybe 7 hours a day of basketball. That's how dedicated they were. We go from training in the morning to class, individuals, to team practice, and we would sneak out after training, after study hall, and then go to the recreation center, like 9:30 to 11.
Right.
And we'd go at each other every day. And the thing with him, what stood out to me, he was always had an old man's game.
Right.
So he always understood. He had a very high basketball IQ.
Yep.
Always had a great flow to the game. Had the game come to him.
Right.
And he's a great guy, man. He plays the game the right way.
Yep.
And he works hard at his game.
Yep.
So it was a great experience playing with him. We're still close friends to this day.
That's what's up. That's really good. I noticed that you're wearing a T on your shirt. I noticed you're wearing a T on your shirt. What is that about? I heard you have a label or a clothing line.
That's my clothing line called.
Okay.
Baltimore Designs.
Okay.
Me and my partner Clive Williams from OCM, we co-founder of Baltimore Designs. I came out with it about a few years ago actually. I started designing clothes and we had something called Timeless. Timeless with a couple of friends in Arizona, but it didn't really get off the map that well. So me just brainstorming and doing other things. The whole way we came up with Baltimore is blackball. So like the concept of being blackballed in your life and being the underdog. So it's a real concept that I try to use to take it to the next level, taking something negative and turn it to positive.
Right.
Blackball scenario, when I put behind it in LA, I realized that I have nothing to show for being from Toronto,
right.
All around the world. So I designed, me and my friend, we designed this pickup logo, and I was raised it ever since, and it's been doing really well.
That's amazing, man. To just be involved in basketball, be involved in the community, have your own clothing line. I mean, you're a busy dude, so once again, we definitely appreciate you coming in and talking with the Rathburn Area Youth, and we definitely can learn a lot from you. Another question I had, I mean, I coach basketball myself, Silver Thumb Collegiate, that's where I coach, and I noticed there's a lot of principles taught in the game of basketball that you can apply to life.
Yes.
I see it every day with these youth that I work with. How do you feel about that situation? And how would you say, what principles have you seen personally from the game of basketball translating to these youth's lives?
I think the biggest thing, I think I had a coach called Coach Rob Evans from Arizona State University before he got fired. He was a big mentor of my life. And he always told me, is if you live the right way off the court, it'll translate into the game on the court.
Okay.
The biggest thing meaning discipline.
Right.
guys that are very disciplined on the court, meaning they don't cut corners, right. They don't try to cheat plays, right. They don't gamble on for loose ball, they just play their game the right way, usually off the court, they're the same way. It's tough, like it's hard to see because some people don't realize it, but on the court is how you live, it's how you live off the court. Like that's the best way to be that happy. The way I change my game now, because off the court I'm a lot more aggressive. So I understand more, I take my time more, I'm more patient with everything.
It translates
to my game big time. Because now instead of being a player where I was always aggressive, making sure I make a play, now I wait for plays to develop. Wait for things to happen. So off the court, I try to take care of things in my life to make it more disciplined, more patient, doing the right things off the court, helping people out. And it translates to my game on the court because as a point guard, you have to be willing to help. You have to be willing to pass the ball. Guys who are selfish. And back in the day, I was averaging 40 points. Right. I was thinking about scoring all the time.
Right.
So when I got off the court, I'm usually thinking about what I'm going to give for myself.
Right.
Now when I'm off the court, I'm thinking about how I can help somebody else. And it translates for me on the court because now I'm a willing passer. Like I'm happier for somebody else to score than me because I know I can score any time. Like I'm happier to help a kid. You know, I've already been through this. So they don't have to go through the same things I've been through.
That's very selfless. It's very
definitely.
Wow. I mean, what a great character guy, a guy who's willing to take time, come in and speak with us on such short notice. We noticed you have a lot of basketball players. I touched a little bit about that. Most recently, I think you're the MVP of the Ontario Basketball Association alumni game.
Yeah.
How was your experience playing with the youth there? I know Dwayne noticed you there.
Yeah.
A few guys that are up and coming were there. How did you take that experience? You look like you're having a lot of fun.
Man, I had a whole lot of fun with those guys, man. Because right. It's kind of like going back in the time machine. Right. You're playing against guys like that. Dwayne Noah is a great player.
Right.
I think one other player, you went to Oregon State.
Yes. I forgot his name.
He's another great guard. I've known him for a couple years. I've seen him grow up.
Right.
So a lot of I just enjoyed it, man. Because for me, it's like looking at myself in the mirror when I was that age and I was just that hungry.
Right.
And kind of naive to not know what's going to happen to me next.
Right.
But just excited for the next challenge.
Right.
These guys didn't back down from anybody.
Right.
They got to picking us up full court, playing aggressive, got a good sized body on it. It was a great experience, man. But at the end of the day, I got to show them, I've been here for a long time, so I got to give them that veteran love. Like, I've been here for a long time, I got to take over the game when
right,
I do, but
right.
It was a great feeling, man.
Wow, I hear that. And that's great to just play at the level you've been playing at for a long time, you know, being so humble as you are. What makes you humble? What makes you not, you know, I mean, I played against a lot of guys in my name.
Yeah.
And some guys tend not to be humble, and they're not even that good.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you said about being grounded, being disciplined, but I feel sometimes to have as much basketball credentials as you have, how do you keep yourself humble?
I think you have to challenge yourself. I think a lot of guys who are not as humble, they kind of gas themselves. In other words, where they're high on themselves, they're not very tough critics on themselves. They're happy because they've done something, so they want everybody to know.
Right.
Like when you see Jerry Rice score a touchdown, he gets the touchdown, gives to the referee. You don't even dance. He's used to it. I've been here before.
Right.
Like you see Randy Moss get a touchdown. Touchdown, get the ball to the referee. You see a rookie get a touchdown, he's dancing for 10 minutes and gets a penalty.
Right.
He has to show everybody he got a touchdown. I've been there before, so now it's kind of like, when I was younger, I didn't understand that more, so I'm kind of more of a showboat.
Okay.
Now it's my game you're talking. I just play basketball, like my game you're talking, other than that, I just try to be as humble as possible.
You touched on one of the key things that I try to harness is hunger.
Yes.
Hunger to me, that's one of my favorite things. As bad as some people say that you are, you know what I mean? As bad as I say that you, especially for my community, I see something that a lot of people see, and that's hunger. Hunger to succeed, hunger to be great.
Yes.
And I try to harness them in my basketball program that I run on Wednesdays. But how would you bring that about? These kids get in trouble, they're using pretty much using their time not efficiently. How do we harness that hunger in these kids? Like, do you have any advice?
I mean, my advice definitely is for people, you have to go back to being a kid.
Right.
How do people think that these kids are grown up?
Yo, it's true.
You can't treat a kid like a grown up.
Right.
You have to show them what happens when you get grown up.
Right.
This is the path that you go. Like, growing up, I know your parents are going to, if you sell drugs, you're going to end up dead on your jail.
Right.
That doesn't harvest to your brain. You're like, man.
Right.
I'm not gonna die anytime soon.
Right.
I'm not gonna go to jail anytime soon because you're that young, you're not thinking about it.
Right.
But now if you tell a kid like you wanna take him somewhere, like take him to a jail cell,
right,
or take him to a graveyard,
right,
and show him this one may happen to you,
right,
that means resume.
Right.
So you show them people and show them things that can get a potential goal.
Right.
And they see and it's like I can do that. Like me watching, I forgot who one of the people was. Mike Schmidt.
Right.
Growing up, Mike Schmidt was Texas A&M.
Right.
And I was I think in 9th grade or 10th grade.
Okay.
And I seen Mike Schmidt come back home from
right.
Texas A&M.
Right.
I remember like yesterday he came down to college, he was playing, he had an arm man on his left arm. Great game, and I remember I playing against him like, you know what? I'm about to enter the play sooner.
Mm-hmm.
You win.
Mm-hmm.
That's a goal I can attain
right.
if I work hard enough. Like, I knew he was great, but I knew I could be a good player, better.
Right.
So giving these youth people that they can see and goals that they can reach and actually go out there and doing it,
right.
it's different
right.
enough. Like, if you just tell them something, it's hard to register.
Right.
It doesn't sink in.
Right.
If they see somebody,
right.
like if they see an NBA player or a Division I player,
right.
they're going to think, I can be that too, just right away.
I mean, I love the mentality, I love the energy that you bring here. I think a lot of youth can learn from you. I mean, I've seen some of your videos, and I laugh because I'm saying, you're still playing at that level. You're still playing at that level, you're still going to work. And I mean, it's inspiring. I really appreciate you coming down on such short notice. Like I said, there's a lot of youth here that want to play basketball, that use basketball to succeed in life, that use basketball to anchor it themselves. So I mean, for you to come out here and just show up like that is great. Your future. And we wish you the best of luck on your season at London Lightning. A lot of us will be following your
definitely. Team. Definitely, appreciate it, man. You got to make knowledge power, man. So if you can give us some knowledge, always ready to go, man.
Thank you.